we have 3 more minutes. Let us wait up to 3 o'clock.
Yes, yes, definitely. One of the real complications is that whenever we try to talk about dialectical materialism more precisely, especially when you are looking for the correct words, then translation becomes a big issue. So, for instance, for today's class, abstraction, what is the abstract versus concrete? Na chat la podren. So what do you think is the Tamil translation, correct?
In Tamil la vandu stoolamana stoolamatra nu potrukanga abstract concrete ku. That's not the right translation.
இம்ப்ளிகேஷன் that abstract is essence. So that's a little problematic.
Correct.
So stoola matranda butu is a bit of a problem. I would also prefer an ordinary word.
Please in that case abiyarda neenga vandu poduvaana appdin solla பொதுவானன்ற வார்த்தை சாதாரண வார்த்தை அப்ஸ்ட்ராக்டுக்கு பொருத்தமாக வரும் அதை யூஸ் பண்ணி பழக்கத்தில் கொண்டு வந்துடலாம்னு
நினைக்கிறேன். சி ஹெகல் ஹிம்செல்ஃப் ஹேட் வெரி கேர்ஃபுல் யூஸ் ஆஃப் த லாங்குவேஜ் அண்ட் ஜெர்மன் இஸ் பர்டிகுலர்லி அன்லைக் திஸ் பிளடி இங்கிலீஷ் இஸ் ஃபுல் ஆஃப் ஆம்பிகுயிட்டி. அதனால்தான் டு ஜாப்பனீஸ் அண்ட் சைனீஸ் கம்யூனிஸ்ட் லைஃப் வாஸ் மச் சிம்பிளர் பிகாஸ் தே ஸ்டடிட் டைலக்டிக்ஸ் டைரக்ட்லி ஃப்ரம் ஜெர்மன். நம்ம மாதிரி இங்கிலீஷ் வழியாக போகல. இங்கிலீஷ் இஸ் ஒரு சரியான அம்பிகுவஸ் லாங்குவேஜ். ஸோ அவங்கெல்லாம் நேரடியாக ஜெர்மனில் படித்தாங்க. ஸோ தே ஹேட் சம் அட்வான்டேஜ். இது ஆங்கில வழியாக நம்ம போகிறதுனால தெர் இஸ் ஆல்வேஸ் சர்டன் அம்பிகுவிட்டி. ஸோ ஹெகல் வுட் யூஸ் ஆர்டினரி வேர்ட்ஸ் ஃபார் சர்டன் பர்பஸ் சார்.
சொல்லு. நான் வந்து குறிப்பான பொதுவானு யூஸ் பண்ணுவேன். குறிப்பான பொதுவான.
பட் அப்ட்ராக்ட் ஆஸ் அ நவுன் நீங்கள் சொல்லறது அப்ஜெக்டிவ். அப்ட்ராக்ட் ஆஸ் அ நவுன் like for instance பொது கருத்து
மனக்கண்காட்சி
அப்ஸ்ட்ராக்ட் ஐடியா
அரூபம் சொல்லுவாங்க தோழர். அரூபம் அரூபம்
அரூபம் அதாவது ரூபம் இல்லாதது
ரூபம் அரூபம்.
ஆ ஓகே
அது தமிழ் இல்ல சான்ஸ்கிரிட்.
we will start a discussion.
Stoolam, stoolam enna adhu sanskrit thane
illa saram abstract vandu saram nu solida mera
enna thalla inge namakku or expert irukara illa shivalingam irukara
மனக்கண்காட்சி
மனக்கண்காட்சி மனக்கண்காட்சி அது வெவ்வேறு டிரான்ஸ்லேஷன்ஸ் யூஸ் பண்ணலாம் பட் எனிவே திஸ் இல்லஸ்ட்ரேட் சம் ஆஃப் தி இஷ்யூஸ் வி ஃபேஸ் அண்ட் அட் தி எண்ட் ஆஃப் தி டே ஹோல் லாங்குவேஜ் இஸ் மோர் டெவலப்ட் தென் தி ஸ்டேட் ஆஃப் டெவலப்மெண்ட் ஆஃப் இட் சொசைட்டி அதான் பிரச்சனையே
ஓகே நாம ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம்
ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாமா
ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம்
ஓகே லெட் மீ ஸ்டார்ட் So I will, I got some feedback from the last lecture. So everybody, you know, liked certain aspects and of course had some discomfort with other aspects. And my aim in the last lecture was to give you not so much a systematic accounting comfort and for padiyalam but to give you an impression of the spirit of the subject okay not so much the details varum but adu endha spirit la approach pannum gerade was one of the was the aim of the last talk So there are four points I spoke about. One is that materialism and dialectics. It is not as if here is materialism, here is dialectics, and the combination of the two somehow materialism plus dialectics is dialectical materialism. So I wanted to point out that this is not the idea very much. So it is true that historically we had materialism and dialectics very often coming from idealists and materialists very often being undialectical but it is the combination of the two in the sense that materialism without dialectics is incomplete and dialectics without materialism is simply word play okay And so, their completion of each other is what made dialectical materialism. This is what Marx and Engels realized. So, this is a very important aspect about dialectical materialism. Namma sort of ordinary life la when we speak about dialectical materialism. Practice la sometimes we also very often make this error of trying to keep the two somewhat thinking of the two separately so while teaching of course is a good way to begin but this is you must realize their inner necessity materialism illama you can't have dialectics illama you can't have materialism this is point number 1 I wanted to make The second point that I wanted to make is the peculiar aspect of materialism, not simply when we are talking about physics or chemistry or biology, where life is simpler, where what is materialism is sort of clear, okay? But the point that I wanted to make was that it when it comes to society that is where the real complications arise so where do you locate ideas so you say on the one hand that it is the objective conditions of life, of production, as Marx emphasized, which gives rise to our thinking, our consciousness, our ideas of society, etc. This is the fundamental point. But what we must not forget is the role of ideas and consciousness in, what should you say, as a fundamental aspect of human existence. We don't act without thinking, no? So what you must realize, what is important to identify, what is the role of ideas in relation to the material conditions of existence, of production, etc. And the point I made here is that the sustained reproduction of the structure of society is achieved by ideas. So ideas help, ideas, ideology help reproduce society. Okay, this is the point I wanted to emphasize. Like I said, even simple things like our habits of hygiene, our habits of, basic aspects of what we consider to be simply civilized life, okay, are learned. And learning is the process by which these ideas become part of the way society functions, okay. So similarly, when you take capitalism, so if you have factories, the idea that labor must go to work in the morning is very important. It's a big difference from, peasant production. You know, a farmer, a peasant, can go to his field when he wants. Very often, farmers are not able to go to the field when it is necessary because they have to deal with some other thing at the home or in the market. They have to purchase something. So, in some sense, they are at liberty to organize their working day in a certain way. Whereas, if you are working in a factory, the idea of reporting on time is essential. Nammale trade union la oru thoilali vande நான் இப்போ என்னங்க நான் நான் காலையில் வர முடியல, 7 மணிக்கு வர முடியாது, 7:30 தான் வருவேன்னா, தென் அது ட்ரேட் யூனியன் வந்து அந்த நம்மளுடைய எனக்கு அந்த உரிமையை நீ பாதுகாக்கணும் அப்படின்னு கேட்டான். நம்ம என்ன சொல்கிறேன், என்னையா ஃபேக்ட்ரி நடத்தணும்னா இன்னும் டயத்துக்கு வரணும், லீவு இல்லை லேட்டாக வர்றதுக்கு ஏதாவது அரேஞ்ச்மெண்ட்டு இருக்கும். அந்த அரேஞ்ச்மெண்ட்டுக்கு உட்பட்டு பொதுவாக தொழிலாளி நேரத்துக்கு ஹி ஹேஸ் டு அப்பியர் அட் ஒர்க். ஸோ லேபர் டிசிப்ளின் இஸ் அ பார்ட் அண்ட் பார்சல் ஆஃப் பீயிங் லேபர். அண்ட் ஸோ திஸ் இஸ் நாட் சம்திங் விச் வி ஆர் பார்ன் வித், நோ, திஸ் ஆர் திங்ஸ் விச் ஆர் லேர்ன்ட், விச் ஆர் அக்வயர்ட். பட் திஸ் ஐடியா ஆஃப் சே லேபர் டிசிப்ளின் is essential to the way factories function. So it is not independent of how material production is organized, of how the means of production have to function in order to produce. But at the same time, they are part and parcel of how this productive process plays out in society. So in the or a somewhat subtle point, we must recognize. Even in bourgeois economics, people talk about behavioral change. At the end of war, little bit they are reflecting, they are beginning to realize this. That, you know, if a new way of doing things has to happen, it has to happen as a process, material process. But where it involves human beings and their action, it has also to become absorbed in the mind as a way of thinking in order to achieve certain goals. Okay, so this relationship between ideas and material processes in society especially the process of productive activity, is an important part of the story. Just one second, I have to speed up my fan. Just wait. So these were two of the points that I wanted to emphasize beyond the usual story of materialism and idealism and dialectics that we are familiar with. So today what I want to do is illustrate something about dialectical materialism and how it is essential to the study of capital. Okay, so idhila vandu Lenin was a very hard teacher. He at some point in 1905, you remember, after the defeat of the first revolution against the Tsar, there was a lot of ferment in the Russian labor movement and in social democratic, as it was called then, social democratic circles. And many people took up all kinds of views, mainly positivist views, anti-materialist views. So first Lenin criticized this very sharply, okay, that there is objective reality, yadartha unmai enbadu onnu irukke, modern science does not contradict this idea, new developments do not contradict this idea. Idala vivarama he described in materialism and empirio-criticism. Materialism and empirio-criticism is a very important contribution in that respect. Adhilla dialectics irukku, but at the same time adoda dialectical aspect vandu avar avlavu emphasize pannadilla, because he was fighting another battle. Adhukku piragu at some point Lenin starts getting deeper into dialectics, and it is the outcome of that that famous philosophical notebooks, volume 38 of Lenin collected works, which consists of margin notes that Lenin made on Hegel's work. Adhila aarambathile and the introduction padichu, one of the things he says is, he says, what is this Russian Marxist, he says, social democrat, have not simply studied dialectics properly. So in fact he goes further and he says, in fact he is very critical of Plekhanov, who was the great Russian social democratic theoretician. He is critical of Plekhanov. He says they have not understood ABC of materialism because they have not paid attention to dialectics. He says very clearly, if you have not read all of Hegel's Science of Logic, you will not understand a word of Marx's volume 1 of Capital. இது வந்து அதை படித்த பிறகு நமக்கெல்லாம் நர்வஸ் ஆகிடும். இவ்வளவு செய்யணும்னா how can our Plekhanov apdi potu oru titti tittaarna, how are ordinary people like us going to cope? So you must take it in the right spirit and see how understanding dialectic and the dialectical method, okay, is very important to the study of capital. Okay, so I will illustrate this in I cannot do a complete overview, but I will illustrate it by picking up three points, three aspects of dialectical materialism, which Engel called the three laws of dialectics. Okay? So I think it is in Socialism, Utopian and Scientific, the three laws of dialectics. And the three laws of dialectics he says, these are essential. What are the three laws of dialectics? Materialism, okay, materialism has not gone anywhere. I'll connect the two. But he said, what are the three laws of dialectics? Three laws of dialectics are that the transformation of quantity into quality and vice versa. And the vice versa ladha maatikiduvom sometimes. So the transformation of quantity into quality and vice versa. Second, the matra video la konjam mute panninga sauriyama irukum konjam disturbing a irukku screen la. Second is the says the unity of opposites, second law of dialectics. And the third law of dialectics is the negation of the negation. Okay? In the third, this is really, you know, we sometimes have a lot of confusion. So I will illustrate these three laws of dialectics from Marx's Capital. Okay, the way Marx develops Capital, how these three laws. How these three laws of dialectics are essential to the study of Capital. Number Yarrow, he says that is essential. He says isn't that Hegelian dialectics? I thought it wasn't used anymore. That is not true. See, Marx had great respect for Hegel, and Hegel is absolutely important. In fact, in the Guardian, there is some silly article. They try to describe why Hegel is important without any reference to Marxism. That's bogus. If not for Marx, Hegel would be forgotten today. Okay? But it is very important, Hegel. What Marx said, however, was that Hegel is standing on his head and we have to set him right. We have to stand him the right say, right way up. But Hegel, and as Engels wrote in a famous in a letter to one of his comrades at that time, he said Hegel is absolutely important, you know, and you know you cannot neglect Hegel. So please, so let's not get diverted by that. So there are, before I illustrate the three, no need to apologize. It was a good question, and I was able to make a point. So don't worry about it. Please ask questions, and you don't have to apologize. Let me be clear. Second, but before I illustrate these three laws, there is some preliminaries that I have to give to you so that we understand the context. So the first thing, and I briefly mentioned it on the last occasion, but did not elaborate a little more as was required. See, in some, for Marx and Engels, philosophy is not something which is above science and then decides what is the correct scientific method. As I emphasized in the last lecture, the dialectical materialism is, for Marx and Engels, it is something that is a philosophy that arises from the practice of humanity. It is not simply something cooked up in the mind that stands there and dictates to what is what science should do or not do, or whether this scientific method is correct or that scientific method is correct. So science is practice, you know, it is our way of understanding the world by both thinking about it, by experimenting on it, but also through technology, by acting on it. So through the practice and reflection, sort of thinking about what we have done, we learn about the world. And dialectics for Marx and Engels is, you know, the manner in which we guide our way through this process. So it is dialectics that way comes out of the our knowing the world, our trying to understand the world through both theory and practice, both the natural and the social world. So the way we do it, the manner of doing it, emerges from this practice. So dialectical materialism rests on the achievements of science, you know, on how we learn to study the world. Okay, so it is not a superimposition, it is not you know, this is correct, this is wrong, velilendu oru judgment illa. It the process of learning through trial and error, through repeated theory in practice, is part of what you call the dialectical method. So which brings me to the next point. One is theory and practice and how of science of producing our knowledge and how dialectical materialism emerges from that. The second aspect, which Lenin was very fond of saying, one way of thinking about dialectics is, he said, you can think of it as the theory of knowledge of materialism. Adavadhu, how do we learn about the world around us, meaning science, etc. So in some sense, dialectics is the theory of knowledge of materialism. So these two points we keep in mind. So Hegel is very important in this respect, because in fact Marx explicitly says so. So Marx, of course, you know, we are all familiar with. So let me, after these two observations on dialectical materialism and this, what Marx and Engels thought of dialectical materialism in relation to science, let me cut that point, stop that there, and start another comment. My next comment is that for Marx himself, Hegel was very important as a sort of aid in his study of Capital. We are all familiar with the book Capital, okay, the three volumes of Capital. But Capital, those three volumes, Marx wrote with a greater emphasis on presentation. See, Marx had written about many of those aspects earlier, okay, in various writings, especially the so-called contribution to the critique of political economy, but that fell completely flat. Nobody appreciated it. So Marx set out to present the question of Capital in a manner that it will be understandable. And the product was volume 1 of Capital. Volume 2 and 3, he was preparing to write. He had created the framework he had all those questions he had already thought about. He had sketched the notes, but they were not in a form where they could be, where they were filled. So unlike volume one, where he, until the proof reading, okay, he was looking through everything, volume two and three, he could not complete. By then he was also ill and various things happened. So it was left to Engels, after Marx's demise, to complete Marx's project. Now there is, you know, people are saying, no, 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 Engels ellathiyum thirthi ezhuthitaaru, avar Marx sonnadhu illa. It's a very trivial debate. If you want, we can discuss it later. But I don't want to get into that. So Engels needed. But he completed on the basis of what already existed in various notes and writings of Marx. But there is another work. It is not clear to me whether it was available to Engels. I think in its full extent, it was not available to Engels. Marx had a set of notes where over a very short period of something like 9 months, he worked out the entire basic structure of the functioning of capitalism, as you see presented in the three volumes of Capital. And these notes, these extended notes that he wrote to himself, was what is referred to as the Grundrisse. I put it on the chat. Okay, the correct spelling, so that you are not confused. So the Grundrisse is actually Marx's working out, so to speak. Volume one is about presentation. You see, you have to present it. The process of discovery, however, is very important to us, because this is the greatest and most outstanding example of the you know, application of dialectics to the study of a particular problem, more or less in totality at that stage. It's not as if, of course, it is totality na, you know, it's as if, you know, he said everything and there is nothing more to say. But without, you know, as one connected story, one sort of setting up a whole subject, okay, a field of study on dialect, on the principle, through the method of dialectical materialism. So, I can, now, this, so the study of this work, the Grundrisse, is extremely important. Now, the second point I want to make and is that I have already made 2 points about dialectical materialism, about how dialectics is not something that stands above. But you might have noticed that I am using the word dialectics and the word dialectical method kind of interchangeably. So you might ask, why? Why am I doing this? Because our idea of dialectics as a method, the way we capture in thought, okay, how the world functions, we think of this in a materialist way. So if there is the process of understanding, the world around us is what we call the dialectical method, then that actually must have its reflection in the natural world. So without dialectics being inherent objectively in the natural and social world, a materialist cannot claim that the dialectical method is the way we think about understanding the world. You understand? Because otherwise we will not be materialists. We say the thoughts arise from consciousness, arises from matter. But if our way of thinking does not reflect the way the world works, then we are back in some kind of idealism. So the way we think is independent of the way the world is. So if we say dialectics is a method, then there must be the world itself reflect the dialectics. You know, the world itself must be dialectical, okay? And in that sense, you must be able to see the three laws of dialectics that Engels talks about in the working of nature. So let me illustrate that very briefly. We will have still to reach capital, but bear with me. So the first of the transformation of polity to quantity, that we, everybody knows the popular example of the transformation of the properties of water, okay? And you know how water changes quality, you know, when we, so quantity and quality, okay? So you heat water and you know its temperature, some quantitative aspects keep changing. And then there comes a time which we call boiling, where there is a qualitative change that occurs, okay? There's nothing wrong with the example. It is there in Hegel also. And so very often anti-Marxist philosophers makes fun of this example. But I don't consider that, a problem, okay? All Hegelian philosophers have used this example, so don't worry about it. Be free, feel free. Only thing is, we cannot stop there. We must understand how this works in other situations. And that we see everywhere, you know, as molecules grow bigger and bigger, okay, not only do their physical properties change, but their capacity to be part of very specific processes that are essential to life, etc., they come into play. So, for instance, the water is a molecule. So is amino acids, and so is the RNA, etc. These are very complex molecules. But at one end, if we had only water, there would be no such thing as life. At the same time, you know, these complex molecules, if you see, then of course they are essential. They are the building blocks of life. So the quantity-quality relationship is universal. But nevertheless, if it is so universal, then you might say, isn't it a bit trivial? Okay? It is not. Why is it not trivial? Because if you go to the social sciences, those who are familiar with academic social science, there is a big and continuing debate about quantitative research versus qualitative research. You'd be surprised. In TISS, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, when I was working there, this used to be a perennial debate. And so I would always start smiling when I heard the debate, because when Engels says transformation of quality into quantity and vice versa, okay, qualitative changes leading to quantitative changes and vice versa, what he was trying to simplify but did not elaborate in that particular thing, that actually there is a whole thing is founded on the notion of the unity of quantity and quality in what you might call a measure. Measure in the sense typically what you in Tamil you would call alavu. When you use the word alavu, you automatically comes to your mind alavu goal, you know. So alavu is a measure. What does a measure, what is a measure? A measure is actually the a sort of relationship of the nature of the unity of quantity and quality. So if you have this thing, water, so there is a measure, that relationship between quantity and quality, there is a measure. And when we reach a boiling point, what happens is the measure breaks down. The same thing is there in capital. Similar thing. The connection between quantity and quality. And this quantity and quality relationship is there in the form of money. Money is the measure of what? Money is the measure of one, how to it helps exchange commodities as equivalents. Okay, it is on its own, it's a by itself, it is a commodity. It's a particular, you know, metal, gold, for instance. But nevertheless, this particular commodity subsumes both the quantitative and qualitative aspects of exchange value, and it therefore becomes the measure of value. So, but this measure, however, cannot function as a measure, okay, unless it is constantly capable of being realized in purchase and sale, okay. So, it is a measure, okay, of the quantitative and qualitative aspects of exchange value, which enables them to be exchanged. But the process of exchange is essential to that property of being a measure. And if that exchange breaks down, okay, for instance, that price is not, a sale does not take place. So the exchange does not happen, okay, then what happens is, you get what is called a crisis. So from the beginning, you have this aspect that money as a measure, as a unity and of the quantitative and qualitative aspects which enable the exchange of commodities. But in this process, when the circulation of commodities effectively becomes the circulation of money, then money as the measure, when that measure breaks down, then you get a crisis. So in some sense, very fact of this simple relationship of quantitative to qualitative transformation and qualitative to vice versa, this unity in measure and the breakdown of measure is a fundamental aspect of Marx's idea of capital. Okay? That is, see, this is unlike anything else bourgeois economists have. For bourgeois economics, money is one whole separate story. I don't want to go there. But for them, it is all about equilibrium. It is all about, and so the breakdown, crisis, etc., are accidental. So for Marx, however, from day one of his study of, from the beginning of his study of capital, in the very understanding of what money is as a measure, the idea of crisis, the breakdown of the relationship between quantity and quality, is inherent to the story. Okay? This is the first law of dialectics in a simple, in a basic way, the way in which it appears in Capital. The second law of dialectics that we spoke about was, that Engels mentioned, was the unity of opposites. Okay? So, there are different ways people express themselves. So, when Engels says the unity of opposites in the language of his time, he means what is called, we call today in a more formal sense in our writing, we call contradiction. So, the relation, so all, if you wish, the natural world and the social world, okay, there are contradictions. But where do contradictions appear? What are contradictions? Where should contradictions be? See, I say something, you say something opposite. Is that a contradiction? Okay. Is anything and everything a contradiction? No, contradiction is fundamentally a property of essence. Okay? So, then you might ask, where is essence? So, essence na Tamil, we can say saramsam. But how do we identify what is saramsam? Okay? So, this begins with the earlier part of the story itself, this transformation of quantity and quality, and how measure breaks down at certain point, how this unity of quantity and quality in measure breaks down. So, let us think of our simple example of water. Okay? You have on the one hand, you have ice, then ice can melt, okay? Ice can melt and give rise to water. That itself is one characteristic transformation, okay, where the quantity-quality relationship changes. Then you have the example of boiling, where water becomes steam, okay, where measure breaks down in another way. So, you might ask the question, so there is, these things are all connected. Water is not independent, you know, water comes from ice. But this constant breaking down of measure, and reconstituting in a new measure, is it simply that's all there is to it? But what it shows is that some underlying unity of which this breakdown of measure, breakdown of quantity and quality, okay, that we can see is the manifestation. Okay? And this underlying permanence, okay, is what is called essence. See, dialectics is not, you know, skepticism. Everything is in motion, everything is changing. So, ella mari konde irukkadnala sthirama eduvume illengirathu, that's not dialectics. Okay? You have to be careful. So, dialectics, so the, if you have this measure, okay, which keeps breaking down and reconstituting itself, then you might ask, what is it underlying this transformations which holds it all together? See, we are not talking about elephants and chickens. No, when you say ice becomes water, there is a relationship between the previous kind of measure and the new kind of measure. They are not entirely independent things, you know, like water and stone or something. So what is it that relates this different changes of measure, this breakdown and reconstitution of measure? What lies underneath it is, properly speaking, what we call essence. So in Capital, of course, this is not a simple story. So there is first you have money, the role of money, then circulation of commodities becoming the circulation of money, and then from money to the notion of capital. So there are steps to undertake. Now, what is the essence of capital? The essence of capital is the unity of the opposites, capital and labor. Okay? Now, you must not think of this as here is capital, here is labor, and two entities. So the essence is actually a process. Essence, when we talk of the physical world, essences appear like things or like properties. Like, for instance, you might talk of the chemical substances. The essence is molecules, then further molecules are made up of atoms, etc. So then you tend to think of essences as some kind of entities or properties, okay, some characteristic. Okay, the essence of planetary motion lies in the gravitational force that holds the planets and the sun together in equilibrium. So when we think in these examples, we think of things. But essence itself can also be a process. So the essence of capitalism is the relationship of capital and labor in the process of production. That's the essence of capital. Now you say process, and then, you know, we are a little perhaps surprised. Let me illustrate this with a different example, which is simpler, which is not exactly essence, but it's a useful example. Suppose you think of the concept of fruit. Okay, but this is not an illustration of essence really, but it is an illustration. Okay, let me postpone this. Forget about I brought up. So the relationship between capitalism and capital and labor in the process of production, okay, is the essence of capitalism. Now, you see, there are two aspects. There is no capital without labor. And there is no labor without capital. I said, this is their unity. Otherwise, we are talking of two completely unrelated things. There's no point. Okay? Capitalism and capital and labor have both to be present, and their unity lies in this process of production. So the unity aspect is one part of the story. But this is also a contradiction. This is also a contradiction. There is an obvious sense in which it is a contradiction, which is political, etc., etc. You see, but capital and labor are two different aspects. That way they are dissimilar. Even though they are dissimilar, without the other, you don't get this. So there is no capital, because there is no money, there is no exchange value without the role of labor. Then at the same time, labor has an independent, it is dissimilar because labor is constituted by the worker whose capacity to work is what constitutes labor. So they are both relevant to making up each other's constitution, meaning you cannot have capital without labor or labor without capital. But nevertheless, they are in contradiction. Capital itself is not labor. So this contradiction, at the same time their unity in the process of production, is the essence of capitalism. Okay? Now you can have essences in different ways. So when asked what is the essence of the working class movement, you can think of essences in different ways. So we may, so essences can also evolve. Okay? So for instance, let me give you a completely different example from a completely different field. Say we are talking of political theory, and we are talking of working class movement. What is the essence of the working class movement? Is the essence of the working class movement, at the beginning there is just protest, people protesting, doing various things. At the first stage of the essence of the working class movement is the formation of the working class organization. So the working class organization is what the fact of proletarian organization and struggle is the underlying thing which these qualitative and quantitative changes of strikes coming and disappearing and, you know, all these things which are happening in the world, the appearance. Underlying all those changes is the fact of the proletariat as a class which is fighting for its rights. But then this process of back and forth leads to this organization then changing and becoming self-aware. So when this organization becomes self-aware, and eventually it becomes self-aware as a class and aware of its own role, then you have the social democratic movement. And once you have its awareness, not only as a class in itself, but as a class for itself, understanding its role for in history, self-aware in that sense of its role and importance for transforming society, then you have the Communist Party. You have first Social Democratic, then in its proper form, where they really understood their role, you have the Communist Party. So the Communist Party, you would say, is the essence of the working class movement. And of course, the appearance is the forms, various forms in which proletarian struggle takes place. Of course, this has to be realized in practice. If a working class is not self-aware and remains at an earlier stage, then you cannot say that the Communist Party is the essence of the proletarian movement. But where matters proceed in, so what we historically, we cannot realize this, the essence may not actually be realized, okay? But where it is in the case of the Russian Revolution, the Communist Party becomes the essence of the working class movement. So you have these relationships between essence and appearance. In the case of capitalism, the essence of capitalism is the process of circulation of production and distribution, where everything comes back to its origin, which involves capital and labor, which both are dependent on each other for their existence and also in contradiction. Okay? The point I want to emphasize here is this is not the same as the contradiction between use value and exchange value. See, use value and exchange value, there is a contradiction. The new thing which happens, which is the property of labor, okay, that arises because labor is a commodity whose use value is the production of exchange value. So with use value and exchange value by itself, you will not have very much. But it is this whole thing of the process of production, circulation, and then realization and coming back. When that is set up, in that the role of labor is the production, is that it is a commodity, because labor power is sold and bought. Labor is a commodity whose use value is the production of exchange value. Otherwise, use value and exchange value would simply be a opposition. Okay? They become a contradiction only when there is, labor and production is set up. So, with the development, so this is the logical structure. You begin with use value and exchange value, then you come to the level of money, then you rise to the talking about the process of production. You have the categories of capital and labor and their interrelationship, the unity of opposites, is the essence of capitalism. Okay? I've gone on continuously for 1 hour, but let me go on. Today I don't think I'll take a break. Let me make the last point about this even more confusing concept, which is we have heard about, but there's always some nervousness about it, which we call negation of the negation. And Engels, in his quick remarks about the three laws of dialectics, says very clearly negation of the negation, he says, is the underpinning of the whole system. Okay? So if you feel sort of always a little delicate about this concept, rest assured, very senior leaders in the party and the movement also are sometimes a little nervous with this concept. So let's try to understand. See, one of the things about dialectics is that when you say things are changing, when things are in motion, okay, the idea of motion as simply a positive thing, that something moves, is a very limited notion. See, because something without its opposite, a concept that is if you take something as a totality, that is different. But if you take any part of the world, the moment you say part, then you can ask what is beyond that part. So you cannot have a notion of limit without the idea of crossing the limit. Otherwise, limit makes no sense. So limit and transcending the limit always go together. Similarly, at various levels, See, even the very idea of quantity, okay? So Marx talks about, so Hegel talks about it, and Marx and Engels, you know, sort of take those concepts over in a materialist way. So how will we begin to understand the world itself in the first place? You have to distinguish between different things. When you say this is a stone, you are also saying something else is not a stone. If you say this is an apple, there must be a category of non-apple. There are things which are non-apple, and this what you call is an apple. It may be non-apple, maybe guava, this, that, whatever. So you have apple and you have things which are non-apple. So the distinction between of something is not independent, is carries within it a negation. Okay? And so, in fact, a famous philosopher Spinoza said, he said it in Latin, but it translates as determination is negation. Okay? So you have this idea of, you know, negation as part of the very process of being to identify things in the world. In fact, this is true on a bigger scale also. If you want to study anything, any phenomenon, any area of any aspect of the world, you have to begin by first breaking it down into its parts. So there are people who say, no, 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 we must be holistic, always study the whole. You can't study the whole without first breaking it into its parts and then getting to the essence and then going back to the full world as a whole. So, in fact, the entire scheme of Capital in all its three volumes is a process of the, in this sense, of negation. So, first you have Marx, you know, begins by saying the world presents itself as a capitalism presents itself as a continuous and ceaseless exchange of commodities. So, you know, it's just many things happening. Out of that, so, you know, you can begin with some abstract idea. Say, population is important to study economics, you know, natural resources. You look at all these things. So, the first part of the process is to find out what is the aspects that you have to focus on. What particular things must you focus on? There, because there are many aspects of the world. What do you focus on? So that process is itself a form of negation. You don't think of the whole, but you focus on a part and then you narrow it down to what is the essential, I'm not saying essence, to what lies at the core, where must you begin? And Marx therefore identifies that the beginning must be made with the nature of the commodity. And from there you explore the commodity and you come to the essence of capital. Now, once you are at the essence of capital, then he just saying this is not enough. What is happening in the real world? How do we understand the real world? So you must go from the essence back to the appearance. Not as something like in the beginning when you first saw it without understanding it, but now in a way that you understand it completely. Or, you know, you understand where it is coming from. So in the beginning, if you thought of crisis, you only think of it as the potential crisis in the breakdown of the relationship between relationship of measure, money as measure and not being realized in the process of purchase and sale. But when you come after having gone to the essence, that is production, and then from the essence to how the world is actually functions, then you come to the full idea of crisis. Perhaps this is so abstract. Let me give two examples. See, take planetary motion, our favorite example. Where did we begin with planetary motion? By simply seeing it. We just saw patterns, regularities in the sky. Okay? And this goes back to ancient times. So at that level, we just see it. Okay, we just then slowly we come. First of all, when we see the sky, we are not even able to recognize what is happening. And for the first time, only with having isolated the planets, that we begin to make some sense of what is happening. Then you have the, you start studying the planets. And over a long period in history, you finally, in the work of Newton, you come to the essence of planetary motion. There is a contradiction here, but this contradiction, the moment it appears, it is a resolved. It is not an active contradiction. And this, if you wish, and let me put it in a simple way, this contradiction is the relationship between centripetal and centrifugal forces. You have circular motion, and so circular motion has a centrifugal force, that is the attractive force of gravity, and this unity of opposites, you realize, is the essence of planetary motion. Then, of course, we go back, and now we can explain everything. It's not as if the world is different, but you can explain. And now, you see, in both stages, what you can say is, in the beginning, we had an appearance, what you might call a show, just what is visible. You saw the planets. There was a show of the planets. And from that, we came to an essence which does not depend on whether it is Mars or Earth or Venus. It's something completely abstract, not centripetal and centrifugal forces, which apply to all these things. So in some sense, the concrete character of each individual planet and their motion is negated. Negated does not mean it goes away. It is there, but in the background. Then what happens? Then, having discovered this essence, then you go back, okay? And you can reconstitute from these basic laws, you can reconstitute the motion of planets. But this time is when we will properly call it an appearance. So you can talk of planets and planetary motion without specifically talking of Mars, Venus, etc. You don't even have to talk about our planetary system. You can talk about planetary systems in general. Okay? So the essence of planetary motion, once we understand it, then you can talk about appearances in any form. Okay, including our own planetary system. So this back and forth itself is a form of the negation of the negation. So the point about negation of the negation is that to understand something is not simply to describe it. It's also to describe what it is not and then come back to what it is. Let me give you an even simpler example, and that was why I started mentioning fruit. Suppose you take fruits. The concept of fruit, okay, you have cherries, you have apples, you have these, that, you know, you have a variety of fruits. The concept of fruit arises. Well, now there are many similar characteristics over history you discover. In some cases, you discover that they have a common structure, that they have seeds, etc., that these seeds are relevant to reproduction of the plant. So, you know, over a long period, we have a development through practice, and eventually we come to the concept of the fruit. So when you say fruit, you're not talking about apples, cherries in particular. Apples and cherries have not gone away. You have set individual apples, cherries, these type of fruits, their characteristics aside, and you are looking at something which is common to all of them, captured by the term, what you call the fruit. But at the same time, if you say, get me a bowl of fruit, somebody cannot go and get the abstract idea of the fruit. The concrete answer to the statement, get me a bowl of fruit, is that it will be a collection of apples, oranges, jackfruit, guava, banana, whatever it is you can find. So there is always, when there is an essence, the appearance is not detached from it. The essence, in a sense, in a limited sense, what you call essence, you may, or what is common to all of them, you may call the fruit, okay? But it manifests itself in the individual characteristics, in the individual examples, and the individual examples together become the thing. In the process, going this way or going the other way, something is lost and or not lost, something is kept in the background about their properties. So fruit does not exist independent of its manifestation in individual fruit. So whenever we consider a totality, when we consider a whole as its parts and back in relation to its whole, you always, in order to understand it correctly, you are going back and forth in a negation of the negation. So this appears, in fact, there are spectacular examples of negation of the negation in Capital. Let me give you one example. So Marx begins with what is the source of profit, okay? So in volume one, okay, let me continue. So Marx begins with surplus value as the source of profit. Then when he talks about in volume 3, if you go there to volume 3, he will say profit arises at all stages in the circulation of capital. So when volume 3 you published, people were shocked, and there were various commentators who wrote that Engels had made a mistake. What is this Marxist theory? Marx said profit arises from the surplus value produced by labor in volume 1. In volume 3 he goes and says it arises in all parts of, at all stages in the circulation of capital. The point is that in going to the appearance, meaning the fully developed capitalist system, the fact that profit arises from the production of surplus value is negated. but it is negated in a definite way, meaning this property of coming from the surplus value is not lost, but its manifestation does not appear in the same way as it is in the essence. So the essence and appearance are not identical. They are related, but they are related through a negation. But then when you have crises, when you have other things, then you come back and you realize that it is in surplus value and labor that capital, that value is, the profit is produced. So there is no essence without an appearance, but the relationship between essence and appearance is that of negation of the negation. And looking at both aspects together is how you properly understand a totality. Okay? So, these are three sort of examples of how Engels' three laws of dialectics are realized in Marx's Capital. Now, of course, this, so let me stop here and listen to your comments, queries, and whatever. Thank you. Grim silence.
Quantitative change leads to qualitative change. I mean, qualitative leads to quantity. Can you explain? Qualitative change leads to quantitative change.
Ah, so that's no. See, let me put it this way. The relationship between measure, suppose you say quantitative change leads to, what did, one second. Suppose you take the simple example, okay, of water and steam, okay? So if you go from steam, if you take water and you increase its temperature, okay, then you come to a change in quality. Water becomes steam. But notice that once it becomes steam, it opens up another range of variables which can change quantitatively. A similar relationship applies to the development of, another example is the development of productive forces. When there is a revolution, it is the change in the measure which is the relation. So the relationship between means of production and relations of production is like a measure. And once this breaks down, when you have a new set of relations of production, that opens the door to further development. It is not an end point, you see. So the breakdown at the boiling point of water is not an end. This quality, change of quality, opens the door to change of quantity with a new set of quantities. They are not the old. So water is incompressible, steam is compressible. Okay, there are all these different kinds of properties. So that is the sense.
Comrade, I'm not able to grasp what do you mean by the measure breaks down. For see, example, measure, how?
How will you? There are various measure
breaks. Can I,
meaning? See, suppose you have water,
yeah.
Okay, water has a certain rate of expansion, okay, with regard to heating. Suppose you take water in a vessel and you heat it, you will have a particular relationship to how the volume expands in relation to the temperature. But nevertheless, its volume is limited. No? Water is not all over the room. No, water is water. It has a, it takes the shape of the vessel, but it has a definite volume because of gravity, that of course, but it has a definite volume. Once, however, you become steam, then you know it volume is a gas. When it is at that temperature, it is a gas. It fills whatever volume that you provide to it. So the relationship between quantity and quality has undergone a change. And this relationship between quantity and quality is expressed by the idea of measure. See, for instance, take statistics. Okay? Statistics is always, we are interested in a measure. People like the Pulli Vivaratla, you know, especially students, they are always confused. Why do we look at statistics? Not because we are interested in the number of 25% poor people or 24.3% poverty or 25% poverty. We are interested because, broadly speaking, poverty, okay, is you know, has to do with if a large number of people are poor, then you are a poor nation. If a small number of people are poor, you are not so poor. Then you may reach the point where there is nobody you can describe as poor. Like, for instance, Hegel has a lot of humorous remarks about, you know, baldness. Mutteya. Is baldness a quality achieved exactly at the point where the last hair disappears? Not at all. But nevertheless, we do understand the meaning of being bald and a head full of hair. Okay? So it's a relationship, you see. So it's a measure. So there are different ways measures arise. Does that provide some more?
Yeah, but how I understood the first law was that the temperature being a measure of a quantity. For example,
no, the temperature goes... is not a measure.
Okay, okay.
Now by measure, I have not defined it precisely, and I am not going to get into those details here. There is a relationship between water as a substance and the fact that some of its characteristics can change. This relationship I call measure. If I want, I can make it more precise, but I don't want to get into that detail. You understood? Temperature is a quantitative aspect of it.
Okay.
Okay? So when you increase the temperature, some quantitative aspect of it changes. But the fact that it still remains water, okay, gives you, so that is what I am referring to. This unity of quantity and quality is what I like to call measure. Any other question?
in the unity of opposites, one force is trying to retain the existing form, the other force is trying to break the form. Can I understand like that?
What part?
In the unity of opposites.
No. That's that the planetary example. How to
see the positive force trying to retain the form and negative force trying to break the form. Can I take it like that?
That is only one aspect of it. Well, let me put it this way. They are opposites. Okay? That we agree. But opposites, the unity of opposites is related to its... see, a better way to think of it is not form. Don't use the word form. Okay? But that the unity of opposites is constantly threatened by the contradiction, by the fact that they are opposites. You get what I'm saying? Don't think of it as form. That's all I'm warning you about. Instead of the word, so in some sense it looks like a circular argument. So what happens, what are we talking about, capital and labor? The process of circulation, where production, sale, realization, coming back, this whole constant reproduction, this cycle is broken. And it will be broken by this contradiction. Of course, it is not directly the contradiction of capital and labor, but it is the fact that capitalism in its development develops fixed capital much faster than variable capital, but it needs variable capital to produce profit. This is why eventually the breakdown occurs, because of the rate at which it increases fixed capital, it cannot maintain its capacity to hire labor and generate profit, and this continuous process eventually leads to the breakdown. But what I am trying to say is, it's the unity, the opposition, contradiction, the unity of opposites. That's why Marx, Engels, not so much Marx and Engels, but really Lenin, etc. onward, we have always emphasized the fact that how contradictions are primary. Now, contradiction is the dominant aspect of the unity of opposites, their opposition. So just don't use the word form. The composition, the opposites, always their contradiction always threatens the unity. See, good example somebody gave is like the repulsion between magnets. Okay? So when you have North and South Pole, they just attract. But if you have two North Poles, the closer they come, okay, the stronger is the force that disrupts them. That's a sort of analogy, even though it is North Pole and North Pole, so don't get confused by the details, but it's a good analogy. And a contradiction is a situation where there is a unity of opposites, that the stronger they are tied together, the more disruptive is the potential that they have. Just don't think of the word form. That's all I'm saying with regard to your original question.
Okay, comrade.
I have one question. Yes, this the recently the development of research on the emergence in science, is it related to the quality and quantitative change, the emergence?
Very much. That's a very good question. See, but some people so emergence is a very tricky issue. Okay, very interesting. See, what is a simple example of emergence? In this emergence, you will see, so the emergence of life from inorganic matter, okay, is a very good example of emergence, generally speaking, okay. For the purpose at least of our discussion, we don't need too much technical detail. See, the you remember what I said about the Charvaka in my last lecture. The Charvakas got this beautifully. So what did they say? There are only four elements: earth, fire, air, water. Okay? Where does consciousness come from? Consciousness comes from within this. So, if you are not careful, the answer to emergence should not be an excuse to say that life means that you have all the physical, chemical and other constituents. Then there is some extra called the soul. So, emergence must not become what in biology you call vitalism. That life has some inherent lifeness which gives it its quality. On the other hand, the other extreme is that it is the sum total of all elements and their connections and their properties which gives the rise to this property, okay, which gives rise to new properties. So in that sense, one aspect of emergence is really captured by the qualitative quantitative transformation. However, we cannot say emergence is an example of quantity to quality and vice versa. What you have to be careful is how do you work this out in process? How do we actually demonstrate this, okay, in concrete form? So the in dialectics, you know, the dialectical view drawing from science is that you must always go from the abstract to the concrete. In a sense, the Marx does precisely that. See, in Capital, when he talks of money, when he talks of profit, etc., they are still in their germ. They are sort of, they are not filled with the detail which is relevant to actual life as we see. Okay? So, they are not also abstract in a crude sense. So, that's why one of the important dialectical concepts is what you might call concrete universal. It is universal because it is the basis of everything, at least for that part of the world. And nevertheless, it is specific. Good example is the hydrogen atom. The hydrogen atom, in some sense, the basic building block of proton and electron, is the building block of all matter, you know, at the level of chemistry. But it's a concrete universal because it's a very specific thing. It's not as if the carbon. Carbon is a concrete universal for life, okay, or DNA, for instance. So, similarly, the commodity and its character, the use value, exchange value relation, is the germ of the development. Okay? So it's the concrete universal from which we the whole development. See, the word development in dialectics is always used in two senses. One, development as in historical, other, development as in the logical development and the structure of the phenomenon that you are investigating. Okay, so that. Did that answer the question or help?
Yes. Yeah.
Are the three,
it cannot be simply taken as an example of the quantity and quality transformation. It has to be, the emergence cannot be taken as a simple example for quantity and qualitative transformation.
No. Is that right? What I am saying, abstractly you are right, but we have to work out the details.
Okay.
I believe that this is only... this is a limited aspect. See, there are other examples of emergence. Okay, let me finish that before then. Other examples of, say, quote-unquote emergence. Say, for instance, it happens when in the whole there are possibilities which are not available when you think of it in terms of parts. So Marx has a very beautiful example in volume 3, and that is the distinction between what he calls absolute rent and differential rent. So rent is, the price that you, what you give to the owner of a natural resource for your utilization of this, typically land. You use land, there is a owner of the land and you pay a rent. So in agricultural rent under capitalism, I am not talking of feudal rent, etc. In capitalism, Marx pointed out that rent is determined by two things. See, Marx always had a labor theory of value. So natural resources do not have intrinsic value, period. Okay, bourgeois economists, now that's a big issue in environment, but that's for another day. But labor theory of value says value arises from labor, otherwise nature gives it to you for free. So Marx, however, distinguished two kinds of rent. Rent arises because there is some, in some sense, there is ownership of the land. The other thing is productive activity. And the right to use land for productive activity, you have to pay its owner. There are two people, the two may be the same, but the two categories are logically different. The value produced by labor, and from the value produced by labor, surplus value, some part of it is given to the ownership of the land. So obviously, if you have more productive land, then the owner of the land can capture a greater part of the surplus value or a numerically greater surplus value. So this is called differential rent. Greater productivity enables the owner of the land to acquire from the producer a greater part of the surplus of some surplus value. But then Marx talks about absolute value, absolute rent. Absolute rent arises when, see, in fully developed capitalism, you have capital flowing between different aspects, different parts of production, different sectors, depending on the rate of profit in those sectors. And generally, it flows from lower profit rates to higher profit rates, and somehow the whole system then keeps going up and down, trying to balance. However, in the case of land, they are able to grab a greater share because of the fact that they are sitting on a resource which is essential and nobody else has it. So you cannot create land unless I go to Mars, I suppose. I cannot create land. So the owner of land can appropriate a greater part of the redistribution of surplus in society, in the economy, than any other sector of capitalism. This Marx called absolute rent. So absolute rent and differential rent together make up rent in Marx's view. So this absolute rent is not something which you can talk about talking about an individual landowner. It arises only because the individual landowner is part of the totality of the economy. That landowning class is part of the totality that gives rise to the phenomenon of absolute rent, which is then becomes part of the rent of individual landowners. So this is a good example, I think, of emergence, a property that becomes part of the individual, but however is manifest only when the individual is considered not as the germ in the starting point of the study, but when you consider the totality. So a very good place to read this is Lenin's Karl Marx biography, a short biography. There he explains it beautifully, and it is the simplest, neatest explanation of absolute and differential rent that you can think of. It's a very beautiful. Venkatesh Athareya once told me, and after that I have never left it. There is one other question. Are the three laws of dialectics related? Answer is yes. And how they are interrelated? See, it's like this. There is a clear relationship in the passage from the relationship of quantity and quality, their unity in measure and the breakdown of measure, and how the permanence underlying the measure leads us to the concept of essence and appearance. And in essence and appearance, essence is both is unity of opposites, and that leads us to the second law. So the first and the second are clearly related. The third, to follow Engels, is part and parcel of the whole story, and so it is there, if you wish, everywhere in dialectical thinking. Okay, so that is the way I would talk about. Does that answer your question, Shivkumar?
Yes.
Or at least that's a preliminary statement.
Yeah. So when the emergence also comes within these three relations, can I understand that way?
In a broadly philosophical sense, you see, the mistake that we always make with dialectics and which irritates many of our non-Marxist listeners is that we don't illustrate this in practice. We say generally, but you have to show scientifically how the scientific discussion of emergent properties is either clarified or guided by emergence. So, you see, that is the beauty of Capital. You see Marx not so much in Capital, but in this text called the Grundrisse. What Marx does there is uses dialectics to develop the structure of capitalism and understand how it works. So there is a somewhat quite a tough book, but nevertheless, there is, let me on chat put the so it's a book called by a man called Mark Meany, capital S. It's a tremendous book. Very few people notice it. What he does is to take Marx's Grundrisse, which is actually the entire sort of Marx's working out of the structure of capital. And in this book, he shows how closely every stage is related to Hegelian dialectics. Specifically, Hegel's book, volume called The Science of Logic, how Marx, you see, in fact, Marx writes to Engels saying that he accidentally, his German socialist friend, somebody called Freiligrath, had gifted him a copy of Hegel's Science of Logic, which had originally belonged to this Russian anarchist called Bakunin. So he gave him that copy. A very interesting history. So Marx says, tells Engels, this has been of immense help, okay, in my work, in my study of capital, okay. So it's a very interesting remark, and so I think one should. So I have spent a lot of time actually in the last 5 years reading here and there, trying to go back and forth to between Grundrisse and Mark Meany's book, trying to understand it. Just simply following the details, but understanding it in a way that we can, take forward into our general political work. So anyway, that's a long project. But it's a very beautiful book, and you will see here. So this was my point, Sivakumar, about emergence and dialectics. I think dialectics provides very important insight into what is emergent. But nevertheless, that must be made in concrete way, in various sciences or in relationships, and not simply as a general state. Okay?
Thank you.
Of course, when you are giving a popular lecture or you are having a discussion, you can say it. There's nothing wrong with what you say. Okay? Don't misunderstand. You are absolutely right. But it's just that when we say more, we must work it out more precisely.
I have another question. I think it's too simple. I don't know. We say that the quantity changing quality, the water becoming steam, but there is a water becoming vapor also. So without heating, it continuously evaporates. So
well, our friend Sajeev from Ireland is here.
Yes, he's here.
Is Vishwanathan's famous example. He always says, what is this?
See,
there are two questions to... somebody said price of the book is quite expensive. I have taken... Aray, all you people must know this.
That somebody is me.
Yeah.
the website. Start the PDF already. Yeah.
LibGen. LibGen le ellam kadaiyum. 10 years I taught climate change and in TISS based only on this private site. Pirate site. இது இல்லைனாக்கா ஒன்றும் லிட்ரேச்சரே கிடைக்காது. இட்ஸ் டூ எக்ஸ்பென்சிவ். சரி இங்கே போய் பாருங்கள். இங்கே போய் கிடைக்கலன்னா சொல்லுங்கள். ஐ சென்ட் யூ அ காப்பி. ஐ ஹாவ் அ காப்பி. ஓகே. ஸோ வி வர் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் வாட்டர் வேப்பர், ரைட்? ஓகே. ஸோ தேர் ஆர் டூ க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் தேர். ஓகே. The two questions are, one, a specific question about how to understand what is called the changes of water into different phases, okay, PHASES. So you, there is a whole, if you just Google for it, you will get phase diagram of water. Okay? So there are different ways in which qualitative changes and quantitative changes happen. And in general, in the world, it's a complex story. So the water vapor, okay, example, okay, or simply put, the process of evaporation, okay, the question is, how do we have understand the process of evaporation? And so the how should I put it, if you have a single variable which is you know, where you don't have water and steam in equilibrium, okay, water vapor and water in equilibrium, then you have one kind of phenomenon, okay. And in the other case, see, the question is, A, understanding the quantitative and qualitative changes in the presence of different, more than one variable. Okay? That's number one. Second point I want to make is, if you take water in a vessel, okay, the process of nobody said that the, there are two different things. The, suppose you have at a given rate, at a given temperature, there is a constant amount of water vapor that can be created. If you have an open system, this water vapor can dissipate, okay, and eventually this will lead to the water turning into steam continuously, turning into water vapor continuously, but it cannot be a closed system. In the other case, what we are changing is we are moving temperature, okay, and that leads to another way in which water vapor is created, and you have the phenomenon of boiling. So it is the phenomenon of boiling and not evaporation that is the example. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
So if Am I making sense?
Yeah, that's right, I think. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, but so for instance, so you may ask, but does that mean that, so for instance, you might ask, what is it that we demonstrate by evaporation? So for instance, if you have a pond, okay, and water is there in a pond, then water slowly evaporates, okay? It does not mean that in this case that, how should I put it? No, okay.
Water is boiling.
Huh?
It's not boiling, it's evaporation. So the boiling and evaporation are two different phenomena.
They are two different phenomena. But now the argument is a little trickier. Okay? The argument is, why do you then say, okay, that qualitative and quantitative changes are, they always flow with each other. See, but the emphasis, okay, here in the two cases is different. In the case of boiling, okay, what we are talking about is conversion of water into steam. Typically, when we talk of evaporation, we are focused on the something which is wet, okay, becoming dry. Okay, like say for instance a pond becomes empty, okay, a cloth becomes dry, okay. So in evaporation, the qualitative focus, if you wish, is different. Now we are not finished with the topic at this point. Because you may still ask, is then this question of quantitative and qualitative changes, the point you are making so general, so arbitrary, as to be useless? That I believe it is not. But then you have to show, not in such simple examples, but in deeper examples, how, why it is significant. Okay?
In this example, can we say that vapor, steam is very different from vapor? Steam engine, we can use steam for as a mover, a prime mover. But vapor, we cannot do that. Is it true?
Exactly. Correct. But what, see, the point is the following. The concentrated gaseous phase and the gaseous phase are continually related, no? Just let me share it with you. Just hold on for... I am just looking for, right. I am going to, can I do screen share?
Yes.
Yes, you can show, you can do the screen share. Yeah.
Let me like, our friend. Like Kumar has done, let me post it on the chat. So can people see it on chat, the one I have posted?
Yeah.
No, not it. Maybe you should. Is it an image or?
Yeah, it's an image.
Image. I have seen the.
No, that's the image
I posted. I've seen the image posted by Sivakumar.
Yeah.
That's a triple point of water.
Have you? Can you see mine?
No.
We
should. I think normally you should press send.
Now.
Yeah.
Okay. See, this is the thing. So here is the or maybe Shivakumar's let me look at
this. Both the figures are matching almost what Shivakumar has posted.
No, there, one second, there is, I just want, okay, so basically the thing is, so see, whenever we talk about, look at this diagram, the one I posted is the same thing as we pointed out. You take this pressure in atmosphere where it is marked 1, and you look at this line. Okay? So when you cross this, there is a point which is the normal freezing point. And the x-axis is temperature, so that's 0 degree. And there is a transition point here. And then this goes away here, okay, where you have a normal boiling point. The phenomenon going along this line is the phenomenon of freezing and unfreezing and normal boiling point, etc., that we talk about. Okay? Now, this is our first clue as to the changes that are taking place. That the idea somehow that these are all part of a unity. Okay? And there is something underlying. But once we learn about that underlying structure, then what we can do is to explain this entire diagram. And that's the whole point. Going from the looking at quantitative and qualitative changes to an essence. And once, especially in the natural world, we understand the essence, we can look at all different sort of manifestations, appearances associated with the essence. It's like if you know the law of gravity, you can use the law of gravity to study all manifestations where gravity dictates various phenomena. So you can study not one planetary system, but hundreds of planetary systems. So I think this is the point we have to take. I think at the end of the day, this is the understanding. It's not simply, can we produce water by other means? Answer is yes. So we now know that because of water vapor, okay, that at any given temperature and pressure, some water vapor is always present. So, for instance, if you have water at this temperature, okay, where we are say between 0 and 100, let us say at 30 degrees centigrade, and you have normal pressure and you have an open system, it can evaporate. But that's not an issue. Okay.
I think any other question? No, we already over the time.
And only one question is there. This natural resources has no intrinsic value. If so, human too is a product of nature, does not have any intrinsic value.
You see, people, the confusion arises in the word value. Okay, by value I mean I value my life. Okay, I value Sivakumar as a friend. I value my comrades. The value of human life, that's one kind of value. When I say nature has no intrinsic value, I am referring to it as exchange value, money, paisa. Nature has no value in that sense. Value is created by labor. So in class, when I have my students, everybody says, oh, nature gives us water. So I said, do we go and stand under the rain with our mouth open? No. It is labor. You have to create a well. You have to dig a pond. You have to have a piped water supply. That is what gives us water. Otherwise, what? We'll be like prehistoric human beings. Even they have to collect water, or you live next to water. So that is the sense in which I used value. See, I agree that, you know, lions are lovely creatures, and I don't want lions to be destroyed. But that is a different value. So you must not confuse value in this moral sense or value in the sense of use value, which may include an aesthetic use value, with exchange value. The fraud that bourgeois economics does in the environment is to say that if this use value is replaced by an exchange value, then you know, if you have to pay for environmental services, then we can control the use of the environment. That's bogus. We have to discuss this in more detail, but basically I think it's a bogus argument. So this is the sense in which I use the value, exchange value, not intrinsic value in the sense of ethical value, moral value, or use value. Okay?
Thank you very much. And we are reaching to our 11 minutes now. We exceeded 11 minutes time. I should thank all of you for staying with us patiently to listen to the class. And we really enjoy the class. It's the time to close it. Let me thank Dr. Jayaraman for his wonderful lecture, and I also thank all the participants. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.